Muy buenas tardes y gracias a todos por estar con nosotros en la actualización de COVID-19. El día de hoy hemos tenido 2.529 casos, 1.963 nuevos casos reportados desde ayer, 1.168 personas en el hospital y tristemente 12.480 personas han fallecido. Nuestras oraciones continúan estando con las personas que han perdido amigos y seres queridos y los que combaten COVID-19. Seguimos avanzando y superando esta pandemia. Nuestras tendencias de COVID-19 están bastante estables, aunque hemos visto unos ligeros incrementos en el último par de semanas. El hecho de que nuestras cifras no están bajando nos está recordando que es importante estar pendientes y luchar contra este virus. Todas las acciones y protocolos de seguridad de Carolina del Norte han ayudado a reducir la propagación del virus y también no tener alzas y no saturar los hospitales. El enfoque cuidadoso y bien pensado, y eso ha hecho que tengamos un equilibrio. Las cifras que ha publicado los CDC y las estadísticas del Departamento de Trabajo muestran que estaba Carolina del Norte entre los estados con menos fallecimientos y también con menos pérdidas de empleo per cápita, siempre poniendo la seguridad y la salud primero. Ahora trabajamos con los negocios y profesionales de salud para combatir y hacerlo bien. Ahora quiero hablar y ver hacia adelante. Primero, cuando vemos de las vacunas, queremos que por lo menos dos terceras partes de los adultos ya hayan tenido por lo menos una vacuna lo más rápido posible y por lo menos dos terceras partes de los adultos vacunados. Y nuestros expertos de salud creen que tendremos suficiente protección en las comunidades para poder vivir de una manera más segura con el virus y dejar atrás la pandemia. Ahora ya tenemos suministro de vacunas adecuado. Necesitamos que todos participen. Al trabajar en la vacunación, debemos de mantener las tendencias de COVID, tales como los casos y hospitalizaciones estables. Tenemos que seguir siendo cuidadosos y responsables para mantener las tendencias bajas y salvar vidas. Y creo que lo podemos hacer. Con el aumento en la vacunación y el trabajo continuo para reducir la propagación, yo anticipo que podremos retirar las restricciones obligatorias del distanciamiento social, capacidad y reuniones masivas para el 1 de junio. También voy a presentar una orden ejecutiva la próxima semana y también seguimos haciendo progreso. Y son buenas noticias para Carolina del Norte. Nosotros vamos a continuar distribuyendo vacunas de una manera que sea justa y rápida y así seguiremos. A partir del día de hoy, casi la mitad de los adultos por lo menos han recibido una vacuna y más de una tercera parte están completamente vacunados. Y los más vulnerables de 65 años o más y las personas mayores de 71% ya tienen por lo menos una y más del 70% ya están completamente vacunados. Estas son buenas noticias, pero debemos de seguir así. En el momento, la secretaria de Salud y Servicios Humanos, la doctora Mandy Cohen, va a hablar de una campaña que lanzaremos para que las personas se vacunen. Aunque hemos hecho progreso, todavía no hemos derrocado a COVID-19 y el virus seguirá con nosotros hasta después del 1 junio. Y tenemos que seguir siendo responsables, tenemos que llevar las mascarillas y también que se vacunen las personas. Necesitamos que los negocios estén atentos a las órdenes ejecutivas vigentes y las recomendaciones de salud futura. La elegibilidad está abierta a todos los adultos y las citas se pueden conseguir y están disponibles a un lugar cerca de su casa. Instamos a todos los mayores de 16 años o más que vayan y que se vacunen. Las vacunas son gratis para todos y hay muchos lugares donde pueden hacer una cita el mismo día y permiten personas sin citas. Son fáciles y están por todos lados. Y estas vacunas es la clave para poder avanzar, para fortalecer nuestra economía y asegurarnos que nuestros niños puedan estar en la escuela ahora y en el otoño, poder abrazar a nuestros seres queridos a salvo. Cada vacuna que nosotros nos acerca un paso más para poner a la pandemia en el espejo retrovisor. Los norcarolinianos han estado pendientes unos de otros durante la pandemia y ya pues, están cumpliendo con vacunarse. Si ya se vacunó, ayude a sus vecinos y amigos, seres queridos, para que se vacune. Si necesita más información, vaya a myspot.ns.gov. Y mientras tanto, vamos a continuar monitoreando los datos y las tendencias aquí y en otros estados. Lo que nosotros vemos ahí en todo el mundo, las nuevas variantes son razón de preocupación. No nos convirtamos en uno de esos estados que tienen alzas. Sabemos qué tenemos que hacer para avanzar: llevar las mascarillas, ser responsables, usar buen juicio, vacúnense. Y estamos muy cerca. Y juntos nosotros superaremos esto y seremos más fuertes al hacerlo. Ahora me gustaría cederle la palabra a la doctora Cohen para compartir más información.
Gracias, gobernador. Como dijo el gobernador, si trabajamos juntos para que todos estén vacunados y mantenemos las métricas en un lugar adecuado, el verano va a poder volver a Carolina del Norte. Estamos progresando bien. Las tendencias son estables. Nuestro sistema de vigilancia de advertencia temprana, que muestra a las personas que van al departamento de asistencia con síntomas de COVID, sigue siendo estable y baja. Nuestros casos están estables, pero el porcentaje de los test positivos han subido un poquito y ya son un poquito de más del 5%. Las hospitalizaciones han subido un poquito, pero los hospitales tienen capacidad. Continuamos vacunando a la gente rápidamente. Como dijo el gobernador, casi la mitad de los norteamericanos de 18 y más han sido vacunados, por lo menos con una dosis, y la mayoría que tienen riesgos altos de enfermedades graves por COVID han sido vacunados. Más del 70% de los adultos de 65 años y más están totalmente vacunados. Eso es maravilloso. A medida que vemos o consideramos levantar las medidas de requisitos en junio, quiero indicar que las mascarillas todavía van a ser importantes. Y los protocolos de seguridad todavía se van a recomendar en ciertos lugares. En primer lugar, los niños de menos de 16 años no pueden vacunarse por ahora. Así que van a haber recomendaciones de seguridad en campamentos y en las escuelas. Deberán proteger a los niños contra COVID-19. Al mismo tiempo, en lugares de alto riesgo, como lugares grandes que reúnen a mucha gente bajo un solo techo, también vamos a tener que tener recomendaciones de protocolos de seguridad. Si bien el 1 de junio es nuestra primera meta, seguimos trabajando y podemos llegar a 2/3 de la población, de los adultos, que con por lo menos una dosis y las tendencias siguen estables, podríamos ir, llegar más allá y levantar el mandato de la mascarilla y aliviar otras recomendaciones de salud pública. Pero tenemos trabajo que hacer. La mitad de los adultos en el norte todavía no se han vacunado y los coloca a mayor riesgo de contraer y contagiar el virus. Para llegar a nuestro objetivo de que por lo menos 2/3 de los adultos tengan una dosis por lo menos, estamos lanzando una campaña de vacunación llamada Recibamos al Verano. La campaña crea un espacio para que las organizaciones y las personas hagan su parte para detener el contagio de COVID-19. Va a hacerse durante 2 semanas en mayo y 2 semanas en junio, durante las cuales órdenes en todo el estado se van a unir para promover la vacunación. Hay muchas formas en que los grupos pueden participar, incluyendo organizar días de voluntarios, entregar recursos y ayudar a programar citas. Hay formas en las que las personas también pueden participar, así que vaya a yourspotyourshot.nc.gov para obtener más información. Si podemos lograr que 2/3 de los adultos en el norte se vacunen, podemos volver a las actividades de verano que todos nos gustan, como reuniones en el jardín con familias y amigos, fuegos artificiales, festivales al aire libre o desfiles. Todo sin usar mascarillas cuando estamos al aire libre. Sé que mis hijas quieren que vuelva el verano y yo también. Sin embargo, hasta que gran parte de nosotros estemos protegidos del virus, tenemos que seguir protegiéndonos unos a otros. Y quiero compartir un nuevo video que nos recuerda que todavía no se ha terminado esto. Para todas las personas que en el norte que hacen el trabajo para que sigamos avanzando, gracias. Se colocan la máscara para reducir el contagio, para proteger a los demás. Encontramos formas creativas de estar conectados con amigos y familias. Dieron una mano a un vecino necesitado. Sigamos así, porque todavía no terminamos. Hasta que la mayoría de nosotros estemos protegidos con la vacuna, tenemos que seguir protegiéndonos unos a otros. Por ahora, sigan usando la mascarilla en público para que las tendencias estén donde queremos que estén. Eso también significa hacerse las pruebas de COVID-19. Cualquier persona con síntomas, fiebre, tos, aunque hayan recibido la vacuna, tendrían que hacerse la prueba. Y si todavía no se han vacunado y han estado expuestos a COVID, necesitan hacerse la prueba. Estamos en un momento emocionante. Ahora tenemos vacunas suficientes para todo el mundo. El suministro es suficiente y continuo. Está disponible ampliamente en la mayoría de los lugares y no hace falta esperar ni tener una cita. Si tienen 6 años o más, y es su turno para unirse al más de 3.6 millones de personas que tienen el norte que ya se han vacunado, que han recibido la primera dosis. Depende de ustedes que todos lleguemos a ese objetivo de 2/3 y más allá lo antes posible, para que podamos vivir con este virus y comenzar a dejar a la pandemia detrás. Tienen un lugar, vacúnense. Gracias, gobernador.
Y gracias, doctora Cohen. Y también conmigo está el secretario de Seguridad Pública, Eric Hooks, y Mike Sprayberry. Nuestros intérpretes de señas son Mónica McGee, Mark Lineberger y Jackie Metivier y Erika Kugler son nuestras intérpretes de español. Ahora vamos a tomar las preguntas de los medios, digan su nombre y su organización. Se lo voy a agradecer. La primera es de Ashley Talley, WRAL. Nada más para aclarar, el primero de junio es cuando va a levantar la capacidad, pero no hay cambio al mandato de la mascarilla, ¿verdad? ¿Puede haber algún momento dado en que se va a quitar esa orden? Respuesta, vamos a continuar teniendo la orden de llevar la mascarilla todo mayo y vamos a anunciar qué tipo de orden de mascarilla se va a requerir la semana que entra, después del primero de junio. Esperamos que este orden de llevar la mascarilla va a ser requerido nada más para las personas que estén en el interior en lugares públicos. Esa es la meta que tenemos. La doctora Koch está hablando de que cuando lleguemos a 2/3 de personas que hayan sido vacunadas, que por lo menos hayan recibido una vacuna, entonces podremos levantar todas las órdenes en ese momento. Es ahí en donde nosotros estamos. Y nos damos cuenta que tenemos una situación en todo el país y en el mundo. Las variantes del virus están muy fuertes y de hecho que ya hemos vacunado a tantas personas. Estamos descubriendo que estas vacunas son eficaces y seguras para que estas personas no contraigan el virus y que no se enfermen gravemente y mueran. Creo que estamos en un buen lugar, pero hasta llegar a ese punto tenemos que seguir teniendo mucho cuidado. ¿Quiere agregar algo? No, gracias.
Próxima pregunta, por favor. Seguimiento, Ashley Talley, WRL. Creo que acaba de poner a mucha gente muy contenta para volver a la normalidad. Una segunda pregunta rapidita sobre el programa que tiene el Estado para ayudar a la gente sin empleo. Hay muchas quejas sobre el desempleo y la gente y el programa Hope Prevent. ¿Por qué no se han abierto las solicitudes y cómo creen que está mejorando usted el desempleo? Bueno, en primer lugar, sabemos lo difícil que es para la gente que no tiene trabajo y es vital que el dinero llegue a las familias para que puedan pagar el alquiler y poder tener comida, sobrevivir hasta que consigan un trabajo. Dimos 11.200 millones de dólares a casi 1 millón de personas de Carolina del Norte. Sabemos que el proceso de apelaciones ha sido diferente, de aplicaciones ha sido diferente para mucha gente, pero por eso el Estado ha triplicado la cantidad de personas que están manejando las aplicaciones del comienzo de la pandemia. ¿Cómo no?
Appeals so far during the pandemic, about 69% of those appeals have been handled, and they're working really hard to try to handle the rest of them as quickly as possible. For the HOPE program, we've been able to provide millions of dollars to thousands of people to make sure that their rent is paid and that the lights are kept on. And the good thing about the HOPE program is that the money goes directly to landlords and directly to utilities. And once an agreement is signed, utilities can't be turned off and people can't be evicted. Changes were made to the law by the General Assembly, and the HOPE program NCOR, which is handling the North Carolina Office of Recovery and Resilience, has been working to put the program back in place with the new changes of the legislature. Also, with this new money, there are new federal requirements, which they're still going through. So they hope that applications can reopen as quickly as possible, because we need to get help to people as quickly as possible. Next question, please.
Our next question is from Dawn Vaughn with the News and Observer.
Hi, Dawn Vaughn with the News and Observer. I have a question for each of you. Governor Cooper, when you saw the vice president on Monday, did you talk about any potential future role in her administration? Would you be interested in one? And for Dr. Cohen, with looking at the mask mandate and if this is lifted, is that going to be just outdoors on June 1st with the 2/3? And what about children under 16 who aren't vaccinated? Will there be a factor with masks in schools?
The vice president and I talked mostly about the pandemic and the response, and she talked about how well North Carolina had done, and I appreciated what the Biden-Harris administration had done to give us a steady, strong supply of vaccines to get people vaccinated. We also talked a lot about the new jobs that are coming into our state and the fact that people need post-secondary, they need some education after high school. And that's one of the reasons why we met at Greensboro Technical Community College. We talked about clean energy because we went over to Thomas Built Buses, where they're building electric buses that a lot of our cities are using, and that school buses will be used with electric buses. And we know this clean energy economy is going to attract a lot of jobs to our state, and we need to take advantage of that. That's about all we talked about. I'll let Dr. Cohen answer her question.
Hi, Don. Just to clarify a couple things on the timeline. So I think our first goal is to get to June 1st with our trends continuing to be stable and our vaccination rates increasing. And if we get to June 1st and those two things are happening, then we anticipate that we can lift most of the executive order related restrictions. As the governor said, we would keep a mask mandate as we moved into June, as we still work towards our goal of getting at least 2/3 of adults having at least one vaccine. So we do anticipate that reaching that goal will take us longer into June, but I would say this is where North Carolinians really need to roll up their sleeves, literally, and help us get to that goal. And once we are able to get to that goal, we can further ease mask mandates and other public health guidance. I will say, as you mentioned in your question, that those under the age of 16, as you know, are not able to get vaccinated right now. They are, it is not eligible for them to get vaccinated. And so in settings that are focused on children, we know we'll have to have ongoing safety recommendations for those settings, as well as in those highest risk settings, places like large venues that we've talked about many times that can be places where this virus spreads more easily. Those will also need to have some ongoing safety recommendations. But I think what you're seeing is us is lay out this plan as we move from spring into summer, as we keep vaccinating, that we continue to use that dimmer switch approach. We can continue to lighten these restrictions as we continue to make progress. But we have work to do ahead of us. That's why we're launching the Bring Back Summer campaign and that Get Out the Vaccine effort. And we're going to need all hands on deck to make that happen. Thanks.
Next question.
Follow-up, Dawn Vaughn, News and Observer.
Hi, thanks for the follow-up. Governor, you said that's about all we talked about, but you didn't answer if you'd be interested in a role in any future or current administration with Biden or Harris. And Dr. Cohen, do you still think that children should wear masks beyond when they're recommended for adults?
I'm concerned about serving as governor for the next 3.5+ years and making sure we do a good job getting through this pandemic. Dr. Cohen.
Hi, Don. We do anticipate wanting to make sure that our kids remain safe until they are able to also be eligible for vaccines. So we do anticipate additional safety protocols in settings where it is focused on children, like schools, like camps. And so we do expect masks to be a portion of those safety protocols. Thank you.
Next question, please.
Our next question is from Brian Anderson with the Associated Press.
Hi, Governor. Hi, Dr. Cohen. Thanks for the time and the question. Governor, I had a question for you just on juvenile justice court proceedings. You know, kids as young as 6 can have to appear in court. There's currently a bill that would raise that age to 10. Do you support that proposal, and would you rather see it raised to 12 or an older age?
Wrong to have kids that young in court. We need to raise the age. I look forward to working with the legislature to make sure that we get this right. It is critical to make sure that our juvenile justice system is doing the things that we want it to do to help turn kids around that are in trouble, to help them through the process. So I look forward to working with them on making sure we get this right. Next question, please.
Follow up, Brian Anderson, Associated Press.
And just following up, did you want to see that raised even higher to 12 years old? But also just a logistical question for you. When can we expect in-person news conferences, and are you switching them from weekly to biweekly?
Well, first, on the age, I will work with the General Assembly and talk to juvenile justice experts to determine what the right age is. You know, I think we'll be able to go back to in-person press conferences soon. We're already talking about lifting most of the capacity and social distancing requirements by the end of May. And into the 1st of June. So we look forward to doing that soon. Next question, please.
Our next question is from Richard Craver with the Winston-Salem Journal.
Yes, Governor, this is Richard Craver with the Winston-Salem Journal. I just wanted to touch base and see if there was any change in how you view some of the reopening bills that are going through the legislature right now, one of which continues to require, would require council state approval for any emergency order. And I was wanting to see if what steps you're looking to take now would make those bills moot, or do you feel like there's still a need just to set a precedent for future emergencies?
I think the evidence is pretty clear that we're doing this right. When you look at the statistics that were released by the CDC and the Bureau of Labor Statistics showing that per capita, North Carolina is among the states with fewest deaths and fewest job losses. It shows that both we're paying attention to health and safety and our economy. I think we've done this right. I don't think we need that kind of legislation. After this pandemic is over, I'm glad to talk with the General Assembly about executive and legislative powers and talking about a lot of things. But I think in the middle of a pandemic, we need to stay the course, do what's right, turn the corner, work together, and get out of this thing, which I believe we're headed toward doing. Next question, please.
Our next question is from Laura Lee with Carolina Public Press.
Good afternoon, Governor. Laura Lee from Carolina Public Press. We're seeing hospitalizations sort of inch up over the last week. We see some other signs that, as you said, cases are slightly inching up or plateauing. Do you have concerns that we've hit a wall in terms of vaccine resistance, meaning those who want to receive it have, and that the remaining individuals who haven't are not subsequently going to?
Well, first, we want everybody to get vaccinated. That is, or everybody who's eligible. That's really the way we can turn the corner. And you know, we have plenty of supply right now. And I think some people have thought, well, it's too hard to get a shot. And so we're trying to tell people now that, hey, you can walk in, you can make a same day appointment. Some people, we need to bring the vaccine to them. They're homebound people. There are others who have not made this a priority in their life, but if somebody nudges them, they would go ahead and get the vaccine. So we know that there are a lot of people out there that will get this vaccine. We just got to work a little harder to make sure they can do it and get it done. Yeah, we have seen hospitalizations inch up. The numbers have been relatively stable. There's a lot of hospital capacity. One good thing is that we are protecting this most vulnerable group. We've gotten a lot of vaccinations. More than 77% of 65 and over have gotten a vaccination. Consequently, you've seen a significant decline in deaths. So, you know, we remain concerned. We remain vigilant. But we're going to keep working toward this vaccination goal and tackle any kind of hesitancy head on. Next question, please.
Follow-up, Laura Lee, Carolina Public Press.
Thank you for that. We're still seeing some lag, in particular, in Hispanic communities. I believe it's, depending on if you're counting fully vaccinated or partially vaccinated, something around 5 or 6%, which relative to the total population is about half of where it should be. What are you all doing to address that, in particular, for those communities?
From the very beginning, vaccine equity has been important to us. We've wanted to get shots in arms as quickly as possible. We've wanted those arms to look like North Carolina. North Carolina has been cited as one of the best, if not the best, in transparency data to so that we can see our demographic information. You can't tackle a problem unless you can see it. And our data allows us to see it. We're working really hard to get those numbers up. It is a challenge across the country, but we can see it better than most states, and we are working harder at it. And I'll let Dr. Cohen tell you about a few of the actions that we're taking right now to make sure we tackle that problem.
Hi, Laura. Well, first, I want to point out that I'm incredibly grateful to our vaccinating providers and many, many community partners that have allowed us to actually double the rate of vaccinations in our Latinx Hispanic population. So it's been a team effort. And again, it is because we are partnering with folks on the ground. So trusted partners in the Latinx community, whether that's the faith community, community-based organizations. I think importantly also to make sure that we had folks at vaccine sites that are able to do translation services or to walk folks through the process. I want to particularly call out our colleagues that are running the FEMA site in Greensboro, who have done a terrific job of creating a welcoming environment for our Latinx Hispanic community. We have community health center, community health workers there around the clock who are really helping to bring folks in, make sure that they're comfortable, do any translation, walk them through that process. And I think that has really gotten out into the community. And I want to remind folks that at that site in Greensboro right now, that they're taking walk-ins, they're taking same-day appointments. So we really encourage folks to take advantage of the resources that are available. I want to remind folks that the vaccine is free. You do not need to show ID to get vaccinated. And we want to make sure you know that your data is safe with us. So we're encouraging folks to get vaccinated as soon as possible. Thanks.
Next question, please.
Our next question is from Derek Dellinger with Fox 46.
Thank you for taking my question. This is Derek Dellinger with Fox 46. Health officials here in Charlotte say they are starting to see that plateau on vaccinations. And so it is fair to ask, I mean, this is something that has kind of been referenced in some of the questions and some of the things that you have seen yourselves in some of these comments. Do you anticipate that you'll be able to have 2/3 of people by June 1st vaccinated? If not, are there any projections as to how that's looking like right now as far as how long it's going to take to get to 2/3 of people?
First, I'll let Dr. Cohen comment on that. I think that 2/3 is going to be hard by that particular date, but shortly thereafter, we hope that we can get there. And we believe that with all of these actions that we're taking, and with North Carolinians pulling together and doing their part, particularly those who've already been vaccinated, don't let that be the end for you. Make sure you're talking to your coworkers, your family, your friends, to convince them that this is the right thing to do. But I'll let Dr. Cohen talk a little bit about the two-thirds goal.
Thanks for that question. One, I could say we are going to pull out all of the stops to make sure that we're doing everything possible to make sure that it is easy for anyone to get a vaccine who wants it. We want to make sure it's close to home, that you can do same-day walk-ins, that we want folks to know that vaccine is available. But as the governor said, then it becomes really about North Carolinians literally rolling up their sleeves and doing their part. And that is really going to be the final arbiter on how quickly we can get to two-thirds. I want to see us get to two-thirds and beyond as quickly as possible, because that is the way we put this pandemic in our rearview mirror. And we all want to bring back summer. It's why we're launching the Bring Back Summer campaign. We know that it's going to take work to get folks vaccinated. We knew that we'd reach this point where we have a lot of supply, which is great. It's what we've been waiting for. Now it's time to make sure everyone knows that vaccines are available, that they're safe, and that folks can get them very easily, very close to their home. Thanks.
Next question.
Follow-up, Derek Dellinger, Fox 46.
Are there any target areas that you guys are basically targeting right now, at least in parts of the state? Is it the mountains? Is it the Piedmont? Is it the coast? Is it a statewide thing that you're trying to get to the two-thirds? Where do you see that hesitancy still, I guess, is the big question.
Well, Derek, thanks for that. I would say we are focusing across the state, but we are using our data to make sure that we are working in communities where we're seeing lower rates of vaccination. I'm excited that we have data down to the census tract level that helps us identify where are the communities where we're seeing lower rates of vaccination and we may need more vaccine providers. We're reaching out to make sure that we have enough vaccines going to that area. If we don't have a natural partner there, then we bring in outside vendors to make sure that there are access points for folks. So we very much are using our data. But what I would say is that vaccine is available everywhere. We want everyone across North Carolina to know that and to go today to get their vaccine. It's safe, effective, and it's free. Thanks.
Next question.
Our next question is from Sharon Van Zieten with Spectrum News.
Hi, Governor. This is Sharon Van Zieten with Spectrum News. Following Pfizer's announcement that its vaccine is 100% effective for kids from age 12 to 15, if the FDA were to approve it and supplies are available, do you think you will require school-age kids to get the vaccine?
So that's a health official question, so I'm going to let Dr. Cohen address that.
Hi, Sharon. Well, we're very much looking forward to hopefully an approval from the FDA to authorize the use of the Pfizer vaccine in those that are 12 and up. We're already starting to plan for our logistics to make sure that we can get Pfizer, particularly to our pediatricians, and so that they can be vaccinating folks. I want to remind folks, as all the vaccines are at the moment, they are in emergency use authorization status. I think that is a particular way that the FDA has used so that we've gotten vaccine out quickly to everyone, and that's been great. The fact that we have half of adults vaccinated is incredible. It's why we're able to make announcements like we are today to say on June 1st, we think we can anticipate lifting restrictions. So it's amazing we're in this place. But remember, those vaccines are in emergency use status. And so while they're in that status, I don't think anyone's anticipating that they would be required at this point. Thanks.
Next question.
Follow-up, Sharon Van Zieten, Spectrum News.
This one will be for Dr. Cohen, probably. Where is the state with respect to the J&J vaccine, and what do you think is going to happen there?
Thanks, Sharon. I'll remind folks that currently we are paused in our administration of Johnson & Johnson. I think what that shows is that we have picked up a few very rare cases of a blood clot. It was literally a 1 in a million case, and it shows that our safety system is working. It can pick up these very, very rare occasions where there is an adverse outcome. And so I think what that tells us is particularly for the Moderna and the Pfizer vaccine, which is the vast majority of the vaccines that have been delivered, is that we are seeing safety and effectiveness in those vaccines. We encourage folks, we have pivoted our Johnson & Johnson providers back to the Moderna and Pfizer, and we're continuing to vaccinate in a high rate. So we'll continue in that until we hear from the CDC and FDA about further recommendations coming regarding the Johnson & Johnson. So we are paused, the safety system is working, and we're awaiting further guidance from the federal government. Thank you.
Next question, please.
Our final question today will be from Jonah Kaplan with ABC 11.
Oh, what an honor. Thanks very much. Good afternoon. This is Jonah Kaplan from ABC 11. Dr. Cohen, I guess I've got a couple questions for you. You know, thank God we know a year later the virus doesn't really transmit as much outside. We also know the virus doesn't really transmit as much between children. If all of, and if the vast majority of, you know, our vulnerable population is vaccinated, if we're aiming for 2/3 of adults to be vaccinated, why would children then have to wear masks at camp outside?
Jonah, thanks for the question. I think we want to remember that it is still all those under the age of 16 that cannot get this vaccine at this point. I'm hopeful that as we were saying in the earlier questions, that we'll soon be able to vaccinate those that are 12 and up. But currently, our middle school and most of our high schoolers still are not able to get vaccinated at this point. And so that is why we would anticipate wanting to continue with safety protocols in those settings. But I think this, what we've been sharing today, is we are headed in the right direction. Vaccines are our way out of this pandemic. We're making incredible progress. I think that's why we're able to say, as of June 1st, we believe we can lift a lot of those mandatory requirements. Masks are still going to be important, even as we vaccinate more and more folks. But that's what I said, we're making progress here, and I look forward to making further as we get towards our vaccine goals. Jonah, you had a follow-up?
Oh, I do. Thank you. We've talked a lot of it about, you know, vaccine hesitancy and the worry about misinformation about the vaccines. I wanted to kind of switch it up a little bit and ask about misinformation, and I realize I'm putting you in a difficult position, but about the severity of the disease and where we are. A lot of people are still nervous with their vaccine to go to a restaurant, to go basically anywhere that they haven't gone before. And there's a poll out that showed many people way overestimating the rate of hospitalization, thinking that it's 20 or 30 or 40% of people with COVID go to the hospital, when really it's only 1% to 5%. So are you concerned about that fear, and what can be done to kind of lower the stress level of people and recognize, you know, the vaccine is there for a purpose, so you can go back to living?
Well, Jonah, thanks for that question. I want to make sure folks know that when you are getting vaccinated, you are protecting yourself, and that is really good. What we have found is that these vaccines are safe and incredibly, incredibly effective. What we're seeing with the two-dose regimens are either Pfizer or Moderna, we're seeing 90% effectiveness, which I will tell you is better than I thought these vaccines could do. So that's really, really good protection. But what we are saying is we want to not just protect individuals, we want to protect our whole state. We want to make sure you're protecting your families, your communities, and so you can feel confident going out to go to your local restaurant or go back to some of the other people and places that you love. And that's why setting this target for our state of at least 2/3 of adults, that is when we feel like we have enough immunity in our communities, in our state, that we are keeping this is virus at bay, and we are able to have more of that protection. And so we're hopeful with us sharing that goal, sharing these messages, that folks can feel more confident as we go forward, but we have work to do to get there. So that's why we're going to bring back summer. We're going to work to get out those vaccines and make sure that folks can get vaccinated as quickly as possible. Thanks, Jonah.
That's all the time we have. Thanks for joining us today.